Good evening. Is this on? Can you hear me back there? No? Lean a bit. There we go. All right. Good evening. My name is Rick Clear. I'm the Dean of the Faculty of Arts here at the University of Regina. I'm delighted to welcome all of you here tonight to hear Dr. Gwynne Dyer speak about an issue that I'm sure weighs on all of our minds, and I'm told we'll also get bonus coverage of a certain recent election. Dr. Dyer started off as a traditional academic. He earned his PhD in military and Middle Eastern history from the University of London and held an academic appointment at the Royal Military Academy, Sandhurst, from 1973 to 77. But not long afterward, he managed to break away and become an independent scholar, something for which most academics would surely envy him. In 1973, the same year that he started lecturing, he also began writing articles for leading London newspapers about the Arab-Israeli conflict. And after a few years of this, he took the plunge and decided to attempt a career as a full-time journalist. The move worked out for him. For decades now, he's been writing a twice-weekly column on international affairs. That column is published by over 175 papers in some 45 countries. It also appears in many Canadian newspapers, although unfortunately not, I see, in the Regina Leader Post. In the 1980s, he expanded to video journalism. His miniseries, War, aired in 45 countries, and one of its 8 episodes was nominated for an Academy Award. His 1994 documentary, The Human Race, won a Gemini Award. He's also the author, of course, of numerous books. 3 of them reached at least second on the Globe and Mail's nonfiction bestseller list. These were Ignorant Armies, Sliding into War in Iraq, from 2003, Future Tense, The Coming World Order, 2005, and The Mess They Made, The Middle East After Iraq, 2007. His book, Climate Wars, published in 2009, has been translated into more than a dozen languages. And his newest book, Don't Panic, Islamic State Terror and Today's Middle East, which came out in October of last year, has already been translated into Arabic and Turkish. And in 2010, he was made an officer of the Order of Canada. Please join me in welcoming tonight's distinguished speaker, Dr. Gwynne Dyer.
Thanks, Rick. Well, thank you very much. Nice to see you all. I'm going to do what I said I was going to do, which is talk about, you know, the Middle East, terrorism, all that stuff. I always keep my promises, but I thought some of you might actually want to talk about something else this evening, too. So we're going to do a somewhat abbreviated version of what I might have done on terrorism, and to leave some room to talk about the rather extraordinary events that occurred just south of the border earlier this week. And just to give you a little teaser, I was talking to Rick Clear just before we came up and in the car, and he said he wasn't surprised. I wasn't either. I went through Brexit in London last June. I knew all the signs before this one started. So we'll talk about that as well, and then, of course, the usual question and answer. But let me start with terrorism, which, by the way, when I was making a crust of bread by teaching in military academies back before I gave up the day job, I used to teach terrorism, because it was a big subject back then. This was just at the end of the European, you know, sort of wars in the European colonies. All the liberation movements used lots of terrorism. And also it was the heyday of the urban terrorists, the Bader-Meinhof gangs and so on. So I taught terrorism in both the Canadian Forces College in Toronto and Sandhurst in England. And there was a whole body of doctrine. How do you deal with this? How big is it? What do you, you know, what's an appropriate response level? And all of that got lost. They stopped teaching it around the 80s. And given the relative shortness of military careers, they retire after 25 or 30 years on a fat pension and get a second job. Don't, I didn't mean that, you know. But given the relative brevity of military careers, most of the senior officers by the time this round of terrorism came around had escaped the education that I would have given them if they had been in military academies a little while earlier. So we've had to climb back up the whole learning curve again. And that may explain why we're still doing the job 15 years later. Two things about terrorism, right away. Terrorism is always smaller than it looks. It's designed to look bigger than it is. The whole modus operandi of terrorists who have very limited resources, they don't have heavy weapons as a rule, they don't have thousands of people to dispose of, and they certainly don't have a cash flow like, you know, even millions of dollars a week, let alone the hundreds of millions of dollars your average government disposes of. So they can only do small attacks, but if you do it spectacularly enough, the media will do the rest of the job for you. They will inflate it until it really does look like the biggest event that happened this week. And that will be the transformation that makes a government overreact in ways that somehow or other serve the purposes of the terrorists. That's the second thing you have to understand. Terrorism is always about getting a reaction. Generally from a government that is, or indeed an overreaction, that in one way or another serves the terrorists' purposes. They don't do it because they like the noise it makes when the bombs go off. They have political goals, they have strategies, and these strategies all hinge on getting an overreaction from the target government. If they'd only been teaching that in the military academies, a little bit later on, we wouldn't have had two wars after 9/11. But there you go. So let me begin with a little illustration of what I mean by very small input, very large output once the media get their hands on it. An example I thought I would use is Canada. We had two minuscule terrorist attacks 2 years ago. You probably recall, because they did make the headlines. The first was some misguided young man, French-Canadian, in, I think it was Saint-Jean-sur-Richelieu, one of the small towns around 50 clicks east of Montreal. No evidence he ever went abroad or was in touch with terrorists abroad, but he had converted to Islam. In the sort of experimental way young people sometimes try religions on. And though I don't think there's much of a Muslim community for him to be part of in Saint-Jean-sur-Richelieu, and then he had gone on to various websites and essentially self-radicalized, in the phrase they use these days. That is to say, he found an Islamic State website, and that led him onto another one. And of course, the whole purpose of Islamic State's websites is not just to raise consciousness, but eventually to get Muslims living in the West to carry out terrorist attacks. It's very low cost. All you need to do is maintain the website. You never even have direct contact with these people. So he was one of these unfortunates. And in October of 2014, he hadn't much of a plan. October 2014, he was sitting in his car in a supermarket parking lot when two Canadian soldiers came out of the supermarket carrying groceries. They were reservists, they're actually civilians. They'd been doing their training and they were on their way home in uniform. And on the spur of the moment, he can't have planned this, he tramped on the gas and he ran them over several times. Backed up, you know, all that, horrible. Killed one, badly injured the other. Well, of course, the police are called, there's a car chase, he goes off the road, smashes into a tree, not badly hurt, comes out of the car, but his hands are not visible, and the cops have rules about these things. You're chasing a murderer, might be armed, you can't see his hands, shoot. So he goes down, he's dead, you can't ask him what he was up to, but of course they go to his house, they look at his computer, he keeps a record of the websites he's been on, all becomes clear. 3 days later, there is another terrorist attack, completely unrelated so far as anybody has been able to learn, in Ottawa, an English-Canadian guy this time, who did actually have a father who had at some point in his life been a Muslim. He was born in Libya. He came here with his father when he was 3 years old. He did not grow up Muslim, but he did convert to Islam, or you know, sort of in his later teens. As is often the case with converts, he was attracted to the more extreme brand of the religion. And again, the same process of self-radicalization on Islamic State and other Islamist extremist websites. And he took a rifle downtown in Ottawa, murdered the young corporal, a reservist, who was guarding the National War Memorial, ran up Parliament Hill into the Houses of Parliament, looking for someone important to kill. And Prime Minister Harper, who was in the building, was stuffed into a closet by security people, and he wandered around for maybe a minute. These things happen fast. And then the sergeant-at-arms, who had a pistol in his desk drawer, being an ex-serviceman and so on, came out into the hall and blew him away. End of story. That's it. That is Canada's total experience of terrorism since the on home ground since 1960s and the Quebec Liberation Front. Four killed, two innocent Canadians and two guilty Canadians. With respect to everybody concerned, human life is important. In news terms, that's one bad car crash. Four people dead. Icy road, spin out, roll the car three times. Four dead. It makes the provincial news, no question about it. It won't even make the national news unless it's a very slow news day. But because this was terrorism, it took over the media for the better part of 2 weeks. Nothing but terrorism. We're all in danger. Do something, government. Who are these people? They're among us now. I can't sleep. Is it safe to go to the supermarket? You saw what happened to them. And the pressure on Prime Minister Harper, who did eventually come out of the closet, to do something about this. Do something, anything. Show like you're, you know, taking charge, was so great that he brought in Bill C-51, you recall, which attacked our civil liberties in various rather small and insignificant ways, frankly. The police could hold you a little bit longer and interrogate you before they had to either charge you before a judge or let you go. And I think it was something about Canadians can now be stopped at the airports and stopped from leaving the country without having to have an explanation given to them about it if they think you're somebody going abroad to get terrorist training. Nothing that really would have addressed either of these events done anything to prevent them. But Mr. Harper felt he had to make a gesture. Something public. Look, we're doing something. We're attacking your civil liberties. That'll make you safer. And Mr. Trudeau says he's going to repeal those bits of the law. I sincerely hope he does, but somebody should hold his feet to the fire on that one. So that's how it works. Now, what did Islamic State get out of this? Not much, but maybe a little. Two things that it might have benefited from were, first of all, in terms of recruiting young Westerners, young Muslim Westerners, to go and be cannon fodder in their wars in the Middle East, there is a competition underway, particularly between those who still are with Al-Qaeda, bin Laden's old organization, and the breakaway group called Islamic State, who now tend to have the whip hand. So they're competing for recruits, and one of the ways you show you are fit in the sort of Darwinian sense is by killing Westerners. So it's kind of an advertisement for your ability to do what you want them to do, and they want to do. The other possible benefit from this is, of course, that there is a possibility, I don't think it came to pass in Canada, that these kinds of attacks carried out by people who are Canadian will turn Canadians against their Muslim fellow citizens. And that, of course, is going to cripple the country in various ways, you know, and again, generate more recruits for their cause. It's a low-cost investment. I mean, they're not training people, they're not arming people, they're not buying people airline tickets and sending them here. They just keep the websites up. Well, of course, you know, every website gets taken down a week or two, but you just pop another one up. It's a constant process. And, you know, for that level of investment, you get an adequate return, so they go on doing it. But you see the principle. Very small input, very big output, because the media cannot resist. Feeding frenzy. We have a saying in the media, if it bleeds, it leads. Sorry, we do. And it's a bit cynical, but it accurately describes the process. What is the lead story of the day? If there's blood involved, it's the lead story of the day. And there's not much you can do about it because people are interested in other people and they're particularly interested in people in trouble. So we can't not cover it. I'm obliged to do this myself. I mean, I'm part of the problem. When this happens, I have to write about it. I don't say perhaps exactly what all the other journalists say about it. I say, you know, calm down, you know. This will go away and it's not that big a deal anyway. But I'm still adding to the mass of material that suggests this is important, because why would everybody be writing about it if they aren't? So it's very hard to prevent this inflation from occurring, even if we know we're helping the terrorists. So that said, who are the terrorists who are attacking us? And what is their strategy more broadly? Well, obviously, they're Muslims. Now, I didn't say Muslims are terrorists. I just said those terrorists are Muslims. And that's a very important distinction. If 1.5 billion Muslims were our enemies, we would be in trouble. But they're not, and we aren't. They're actually Arabs, overwhelmingly Arabs. And Arabs are only a quarter of the world's Muslims. All 19 hijackers in 9/11 were Arabs, mostly Saudi Arabians, a few Egyptians. All the people involved in the attacks in France and Belgium last year, or in the past year, were Arabs. Some born in France and Belgium, some who came there more recently. And most of the people in between in that 15-year span of time, Arabs. This does not come out of the three quarters of the Muslim world that isn't Arab. No Turks. No Iranians. However much you may dislike the Iranian regime, they're not attacking us. No Indonesians. So on. It's the Arabs, and it is the Arab world that we have to focus on if we want to know where this is coming from. And why, and what might you do about it, and how big a threat is it? And as soon as you look at the Arab world, two things become clear. It's in a dreadful state because it is all dictatorships from one end to the other. There's one exception, which is only about 5 years old, and that's Tunisia. Up, you know, when the nonviolent revolution of 2011. Apart from that, the Egyptians did it, but then they threw it away. You know, they're back with a military dictator now. Apart from that, 15 countries, 350 million people, and not a single functional democracy. A couple of countries that pretend to be democracies, like Lebanon, but nothing I would call a serious democracy. Which is extraordinary in today's world, because democracy is the norm. There's one dictatorship left in the entire Western Hemisphere, Cuba. Venezuela, what you may not like, the government there is not a dictatorship. One dictatorship left in all of Europe. Belarus. Half of Africa is democratic. Most of Asia is democratic, with the one great exception of China. And indeed, the rest of the Muslim world is largely democratic. Turkey's democratic. Indonesia's democratic. Bangladesh, Pakistan, even Iran, Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, is a democratic country. So the Arab world is a real outlier in terms of its political arrangements, and partly as a result of those political arrangements, it is also the second poorest region of the planet. This is a bit distorted in the Western perception, because there's a few Arab countries in the far east of the Arab world, out in the Arabian Peninsula, who are sitting on large amounts of oil, and they are still rich, though not as rich as they used to be, because the population has ballooned. But apart from them, the Arab countries are very poor, and getting poorer. They've been in, living standards have been in decline for about 30 years, because the population grows and the economy barely grows at all, if at all. So there's plenty of reasons for Arabs to be cross. Living in dictatorships under the rule of people, either military dictators or royal families who are exploitative, ripping the country off, and rather oppressive. We're not talking about our own dear queen here. You know, waving from balconies and opening nursery schools? No, this is different. And there's a lot of anger in the Arab world, directed at these regimes, initially not at us. And the attempts to overthrow these regimes began in the latter 1970s. And the peculiarity that makes this an unusual kind of liberation movement, you might call it, is that the dominant ideology of the Arab revolutionaries who have been trying to overthrow these kings and dictators has been what we call Islamism in the West. Now, that's not actually the word that they use in Arabic, but you do hear the word Islam in there, and it leads people to think it is some sort of religious doctrine. It's a revolutionary doctrine. It is not a religion. It draws on a fairly extreme version of Islam for its assumptions about God's will and so on, but it is explicitly a revolutionary doctrine designed for a Muslim audience. And the way it goes is this. What the Islamists would say is that we have been trying to modernize, to raise living standards, to become prosperous, to become powerful enough to deal with Western interventions, because the European empires keep coming back, although they allegedly left in the 50s. And so we need to be powerful. We need power, we need prosperity. Oh yeah, and we wouldn't mind some respect after having lived under foreign rule for 1,000 years. So the agenda that they address is an agenda every Arab would agree with. We are sick of being poor, we're sick of being oppressed, and we would like some respect. And the Arab world began, after it got its independence in the 1950s, by attempting to modernize in the Western European style or the North American style. I mean, we were the first out the gate on that. We sort of built the pathway. And so they tried to do it the way we did. And they, you know, so we build school systems and we create industry and we lay the foundations for science and technology, and work real hard at it, and hey presto, in 1.5 generations, you'll be as rich as the Germans. Well, you know, it didn't happen. And it didn't happen, in my view, basically, because the regimes to the extent that they were even interested in doing this, were totally incapable of doing it. They were the wrong people to be trying. You know, the king of Morocco or some young army lieutenant who takes over Libya or Syria or Egypt is not the kind of person you would have in charge of building school systems and building industry and, you know, creating the basis for a scientific and technologically competent society. So it all failed, and by the 70s it was clear it had failed, and they're looking for still power and respect and prosperity. And what the Islamists said to them was, look, the reason we have failed is because God does not want Muslims to copy the infidel West. We have failed because we were barking up entirely the wrong tree. God doesn't want Muslims to copy the European path to power, prosperity, etc. What we have to do, quite different, we have to make sure that everybody in the country does exactly what we know to be God's will. Literally, everybody obeying all of God's rules. And their version of God's rules is fairly extreme compared to mainstream Islam. They're pretty far out on the extreme edge of the religionists, and every religion's got an extreme edge, as you know. But if we do, if everybody in the country has stopped smoking and stopped drinking alcohol and doesn't listen to music anymore because God doesn't want us listening to music, it distracts us from our prayers. And if every man has allowed his beard to grow because God does like beards, but he hasn't trimmed it because God doesn't like beards to be trimmed, and no woman goes out without being covered from head to toe and being accompanied by an adult male relative, and 1,000 other nitpicking details of dress and behavior that apparently God insists on before you get to be rich and powerful, then when everybody is doing that like some enormous nationwide line dance, then God will give us the power and the prosperity. And quite literally, we do not need to build the industry and the nursery schools and the education system and all the rest of it. God will give it that once we are living right. Of course, we still have to have a revolution because you guys got to put us in power so that we can force everybody to live like that. But at least now we've got a program for what we do after we get into power that you might believe will work if you're really devout and kind of stupid. And most Arabs aren't stupid. And this is magical thinking, and although it will appeal to some desperate people, it won't take in most people in the Arab world, and it never has. Even given the desperation and the poverty and oppression that Arabs live in, I would say that there's probably never been a country in the Arab world where the level of belief in this kind of thing went above 20%. Mostly more like down around 15-10%, which is enough to get you started, but it's not enough for the end game. And so what you had in the Arab world was revolutionary. The dominant revolutionary doctrine is this Islamist doctrine. Of course, now we have the problem of getting the message out, because these regimes are not just oppressive in the sense of preventing your actions from defying them. They're also in complete control of all the mass media. So you can't get the message out, here we are, this is what we believe, support us when we want to, when we finally go out in the streets, you'll be with us. How do we get people to know we're here and what our beliefs are? And the answer is terrorism. In a media-controlled environment, one of the only ways you can break through and get public attention is by blowing things up, as many other terrorist groups have also found. But if you blow up a busload of policemen downtown, you will be noticed. They won't be able to pretend you're not there anymore. They will undoubtedly say horrible things about you, but people will know there's a group out there who want to overthrow this dictator, and if they're sufficiently fed up with the dictator, they may at least look into who these people are and what their ideas are, and if you ask around, you can always find somebody who knows. And terrorism has the additional benefit of making the regime go crazy and become far more repressive than it was before. By and large, oppressive regimes don't want to put more energy into beating people up than they absolutely have to. Because it tends, you know, first of all, it takes a lot of manpower, and secondly, it pisses them off. So, you know, if you are a terrorist, your aim is to get the government to behave as badly as possible in order to alienate people from the government. They probably don't love it already, but they'd rather keep their heads down and not be noticed. But you can't keep your head down anymore because we're killing soldiers and policemen and judges and civil servants and politicians, and they're all furious and terrified, and they're desperately looking through the society to figure out who these terrorists are. They don't wear badges, you know. And in the course of doing that, they take their gloves off and people get hurt a lot. You know, we can't find Muhammad. We're sure he was in that attack last week. His sisters live there, and one is at university in the other city. Let's arrest them and torture them. They probably know. So terrorism radicalizes people by making them angrier at the government because of the way the government is responding. And there you have it again, small number of people attacking governments, doing symbolically big things which are inflated by the media, and even in the, because the governments generally don't, you really should pretend this isn't happening, but it's, they, you know, they haven't all gone to military academy either, at least not one I taught in. And, well, actually, I think there were a few at Sandhurst. And so gradually you begin to build a base of support in the population, which on the great day will come out and, you know, they just can't stand, you can't live with this government anymore, this regime, and so, yeah, we'll come out, risk our lives, put you in power. That's a theory. 25 years of terrorism in the Arab world and they didn't get a single success in 15 countries. Blood all over the wall. Between the late 90s and the end of the 20th century, say 22, 23 years, there were so many attacks and so many retaliations, which are quite often involved indiscriminate killing of people suspected of being associated with terrorists, that there were about 300,000 Arabs killed. 300,000, that's a small war. Pretty big war, actually. In the struggles between Arab, you know, civilians and a few terrorists and the Arab regimes. There was, I mean, they seized the Grand Mosque in Mecca right at the start with a couple of hundred fanatics, heavily armed, rather like dissident Catholics taking over the Vatican with heavy weapons. And it took the Saudi Arabian army, this is the most sacred site in the Muslim world, took the Saudi Arabian army 3 weeks and 600 casualties to get them out. There were urban uprisings in cities like Hama in Syria, led by the Muslim Brotherhood, that one. The Syrian army went in, isolated the middle of the city, and then killed everybody in the middle of the city, men, women, children, old people, doesn't matter. Kill them all, let God sort them out. Civil war in Algeria lasted right through the 90s, between the military regime and the Islamists, but of course the people caught between in the villages were the people who got killed all the time. 150,000 dead there alone. And at the end of all that blood and terror, not a single success. They never cracked 20% popular support, in my personal view. However much you hated the regime, you didn't believe these people had the solution. And so the regime, the revolutions never happened. Terribly discouraging if you are an Islamist. And they were a fairly discouraged crowd by the end of the 20th century. Most, you know, half the people they'd known were dead by now too. And it's at this point that bin Laden, Osama bin Laden, whose name I'm sure you're familiar with, came up with an alternative strategy. He's an Islamist. He was born, well, he's dead now, of course, but he was born in Saudi Arabia in the 50s, graduated from university in Riyadh in the 70s. He was radicalized. He became an Islamist while he was at university. He came from a very rich family, actually. His father was a billionaire in construction. Construction's Arabic for corruption, by the way. And so radicalized and looking to make a revolution happen in Saudi Arabia, he quickly realized, and to his great disappointment, there's never going to be a revolution here, certainly not in my lifetime, because Saudi Arabia got enormously rich in the beginning of the 1970s when the price of oil went up tenfold. And the Saudi Arabian government, not being completely stupid, realized that his future lies in making sure everybody's on the payroll. And so they put the entire population on the payroll. You know, being born Saudi Arabian was, and to a certain extent still is, winning the lottery. 60% of Saudi Arabian adults, even now, work for the government. They're difficult jobs. You've got to show up twice a month to collect the checks. But most of them don't involve much more. And so, you know, don't expect this population to rise up in wrath and overthrow the royal family. It's not going to happen, guys. So, you know, wrong nationality to be born into if you are, in fact, an Islamist revolutionary. He finished university in 75, I think it was, and was kicking around in Saudi Arabia. He'd already come to the attention of the authorities, but was not, in fact, had not been arrested at that point, but already desperately disillusioned at the prospects for doing a revolution in his country. So when the Russians invaded Afghanistan in 1979, he, like about 10,000 other young Arabs, almost all of them Islamists, volunteered, went off to fight the infidel army, the Russian army, that had invaded a Muslim country. And I think a lot of what drove them was frustration with trying to do what they'd come to do in their own countries. Here we get brownie points, and it's exciting, and we're fighting the sacred cause in another place, in another way. And they became involved with the Afghan resistance, which of course had grown already, but they were from outside, they had money, they had access to better weapons, and they were rather more sophisticated than your average Afghan villager. And so over the 10 years of the struggle against the Soviet invaders, which was horrible, I mean, there was 1 million Afghans killed and about 6 or 7 million refugees outside the country, in Pakistan and Iran. Over that 10 years, the Afghans fighting the Russians are heavily influenced by the presence of these very impressive young Arab Islamists who come all this way to fight for us and know the Quran a lot better than we do, and you know, they're bringing us wisdom from abroad. So actually the Afghan resistance movement becomes increasingly Islamist, and in fact that's where we get the Taliban from eventually. After 10 years the Russians go home. Everybody goes home after a while. In post-colonial Africa, Asia, Latin America, Western armies go in from time to time, and from this, in this perspective, the Soviet army was kind of a Western army. I mean, it's part of Europe. And they fight for a while. They never lose battles because they've got heavy weapons coming out their ears, but they do suffer a steady drain of casualties. And in the end, people back home say, enough of this, bring the soldiers home. It's not worth the casualties to stay there. You know, like the Americans left Vietnam. You know, they never lost a battle in Vietnam, but they ended up with 55,000 dead soldiers. And at that point, the parents of America said, enough, bring the soldiers home. I don't want my kid to be the last kid dies in Vietnam. And even if we all go home, I don't think the Vietnamese are going to follow us home and invade California. So let's get out of here. And exactly the same thing happened to the Russians in Afghanistan. 10 years, 14,000 Russian dead. And Gorbachev comes to power in 1986. And the demand by then from Russian parents, get our kids out of there, is mounting rapidly. And in 89, he pulls them all out, leaving Afghanistan to its own devices. So who is going to come to power in Afghanistan? And the answer is, of course, the Islamists. They led the resistance. The Russians went. I guess we drove them out. Hurrah, who's going to run the place? Well, they've got the guns and they're also the heroes. So on two counts, they are the likeliest people to inherit power, which, of course, with the Taliban, they did. Now, the Arabs who had been there for 10 years are not going to be part of the Taliban government. Wrong nationality. You don't even speak the local language very well. And they can't go home because by now they're all wanted men back home in the Arab world. And so they're hanging around in Afghanistan trying to figure out what to do next. And it's all very clear already that the Islamist uprisings aren't going to happen in the Arab world, that this strategy is not bringing us to power. They initially expected almost an instant victory, as people do in these events. And it's bin Laden who has the big new idea. Same ideology, of course, and the same goals, of course. But the path now that he thinks might work is if you lead a resistance movement in a Muslim country to a foreign invasion, you do get power when they go home, as they always do. That is the message of the war we just fought in Afghanistan. Nothing else is working. Why don't we try that? And in about 91 or 92, as well as you can track the discussions among bin Laden and his merry men in the camps of southern Afghanistan, this idea takes root. And I think he has legitimate claim to have seen the potential in this alternative approach. We're not trying to make a revolution anymore. We can't get them off their asses. They just don't buy into the idea. But if a foreign army invades and we lead the resistance and we win and they go home, we get power. So he begins, and who are we going to get to invade next time? You're not going to sucker the Russians into doing this twice. So who else have we got? And the answer is, of course, the United States. The only other power, infidel power, with the military reach and the financial resources to send an army all the way to the Middle East. So how do we provoke the Americans into doing that? And he begins attacking American targets in the Middle East and Africa in the 90s, because after all, he doesn't have much in the way of resources, A few hundred men, not much money, no heavy weapons. So truck bombs outside American embassies in Kenya and Tanzania, big truck bombs that killed and wounded about 4,000 people. How many of those were Americans? 12. 12 dead. Bill Clinton didn't bother invading any Arab country over that. He just sent some cruise missiles and sprinkled them over the camps in southern Afghanistan. Job done. And so then they attack an American warship at an Arab port in Aden, about 96 or 7, I think it was. Blew a hole in the side of it, killed 17 American sailors. Again, not enough. You can't get the Americans to invade over 17 dead, particularly if they're not seen, they're not on television, they were in the ship and foreign parts. So a few more cruise missiles, sprinkled on the camps, and that's that. The idea of attacking America directly on home soil and with a mass casualty attack probably did not occur to him until 97 or 98. And the planning probably didn't begin until 99. So it took 2 years to plan. It was a very complicated attack. 20 people directly involved. You had to infiltrate them all into the states. It would only work at number of foreigners coming in, four of them taking flying lessons in the United States and provoking one FBI office in Omaha, I think it was, to report that there's a bunch of Arabs here. They're learning to fly, but they seem curiously uninterested in learning how to land. There was a report to that effect. But, it hadn't occurred to anybody that there might be such an attack, so it got, stuffed in a... it wasn't a plot or anything. It didn't get acted on because that's peculiar. But, what does that tell us? Nothing. And so the attacks go in September of 2001 and kill 3,000 people, and they do it on live television. By the end of the afternoon, when the Twin Towers collapsed, 80% of the American public was watching it live. The impact of that on the U.S. public was overwhelming. Any government, any American administration, after that, was going to have to invade some Muslim country. I mean, which one doesn't much matter, because Americans aren't good at geography, even though they fight wars, and it is God's way of teaching Americans geography. Nevertheless, you know, fine distinctions like, you know, Morocco or Yemen don't arise much in the average American's mind, but kick some ass, punish somebody. We need action here. And frankly, if Al Gore had won in the 2000 election, well, he did, sort of, didn't he? He would have had to invade. It wasn't optional. And you get the invasion, first of all, of Afghanistan, which is not exactly what bin Laden had in mind, because after all, he's an Arab, and they've already got an Islamist government, so this is not actually producing, but he couldn't do it from anywhere else. He was a wanted man, he had to do it from there, the Americans knew he was there. You know, it's a start, we'll see where it goes from here. And boy, did it go from there, because 16 months after Afghanistan, Mr. Bush invaded Iraq. Yeah? What was he thinking? There were no Islamists in Iraq. Saddam Hussein killed them all. And of course they were trying to kill him. It had nothing to do with terrorism. Didn't have any weapons of mass destruction either, but you know. Never mind why, some mysteries will not be given to us to understand. But he did it, and of course, when he did it, all the Islamist revolutionaries in the Arab world throw off their frustrations and flock to Iraq to lead the resistance against the American invaders. And the resistance in Iraq starts in 2 weeks. And it's led by people from all over the Arab world, Islamists. The organization they create in Iraq is called, initially, Al-Qaeda in Iraq, after bin Laden's organization, Al-Qaeda. They fight the Americans for 8 years in Iraq before the Americans finally go home in 2011, inflicting about 4,500 dead casualties, but at least four or five times that many seriously wounded. As battlefield medicine gets better, the ratio of wounded who survive to the dead goes up very high, but they're very badly injured people. And the Americans go home and they build some more. And in 2010, they changed their name to Islamic State in Iraq. And in 2012, after they've expanded into Syria next door, which is now undergoing a civil war, they become Islamic State in Iraq and Syria, ISIS, ISIS. And in 2014, they put together all of their holdings in Iraq and their new holdings in Syria, eastern half of Syria, western half of Iraq, but join them, and Islamic State becomes an actual country. 5 million people, two big cities, government, an army, a budget, oil, the whole thing. Not bad going for a handful of people with no money or heavy weapons. And that's who we're up against. It's not a monster, and it didn't appear from nowhere. It is the same organization. The people who are leading Islamic State today were the people, most of them, the leading people, were people who went to Iraq in 2003 to fight the American invasion. There's complete continuity. These are very experienced people by now. And so eventually we're dragged back into the conflict after they overrun an awful lot of territory in Syria and Iraq. And there's even 1,000 Canadian soldiers out there, not in combat, but training the Kurds to fight the Islamic State in northern Iraq. And Americans are bombing all over the place. We were doing some bombing too. Russians are there bombing as well now. How are we to make of all this? Well, the first thing to make of it is even after all the excesses they've had, it's still a very small threat. They're not even going to take over all of Syria or all of Iraq. There was a moment about a year ago when they were close to taking over Syria because the Syrian regime's army was tottering. And that's when the Russians went in, end of September last year. And they basically solved the problem of the restored the morale of the Syrian army, And now it is extremely unlikely, verging on impossible, for the Islamic State to imagine that one day they will rule all of Syria, which would actually make them a more serious player on the chessboard. They're not going to overrun the rest of the Arab world. They're not going to overrun the rest of the Muslim world, and they certainly aren't going to overrun the rest of the world. I mean, any big ideas is commonplace, are commonplace among radical groups of every sort. You know, one day we will rule the world. After where you had a hot dinner for every group movement that has said that, you'd actually get a lot of weight put on. But they're not a great threat. And in fact, I think they're a dwindling threat, even in the Middle East, to their neighbors. They managed to make more progress with this strategy than had been made with the previous one. But it also has a sort of limited shelf life, and I think it's run out. So what happens next is quite probably, particularly given that Mr. Trump is liable to make a deal with the Russians to stamp out Islamic State and restore the Assad regime to power over all of Syria, which will be a pretty bloody business, but it will eliminate Islamic State as a country. The people who have the ideology, those who survive the collapse of the Islamic State, I'm assuming it does over about the next 18 months to 2 years, will still be Islamists, they will still be revolutionaries, they will still be willing to use terrorism, so terrorism will not vanish. The war against terrorism, I hate the phrase, but the war against terrorism is like the war against crime, which is often declared by various politicians. And you know in your heart that when a politician promises you a war on crime, he's not really promising that all the criminals will one day be arrested, come out with their hands up, and then there will be no more crime. He's just saying we'll get the crime rate down. And I think you have to view a war on terrorism in exactly the same way. The only thing you're going to accomplish is to get the terrorism rate down, and we've done that. It's really very low. You have a much greater risk of drowning in the bathtub than you do of being killed by terrorists, so do be careful of the soap. And how will it all end? I think it will all end with them aging out. They're not going to change their minds after these decades of struggle and sacrifice, but they're getting older and they aren't as attractive to the younger generation. I mean, they're still recruits, of course. The world is full of 18-year-old males. They'll join anything that looks exciting, gives them a role in the world. But most of them go off it after a couple of years, and if it's dad's ideology, they're less attracted in the first place. So, you know, eventually ideologies, revolutionary ideologies in particular, die out with the people who held them. They don't get transmitted unchanged. Look at not to compare them, but consider what happened to the separatist movement in Quebec. It aged out, basically. And I'm not calling the separatists terrorists at all, but I'm just saying big ideas like that have a shelf life. And it's basically tied to the generation that fell for them. So yeah, eventually it will die down, but we'll have other problems to worry about. We already do. So here is where, with an enormous grinding of gears, I move on from terrorism to, I guess you'd call it Trumpism. I think you have to admit that the Brexit vote in June in Britain, leaving the European Union and inflicting serious damage upon the European Union, followed by an election in the United States that delivers a man like Trump, and I need not go into his multifarious defects, and you know we've been wading through that for a while, but he would normally be unelectable. And in fact, he's never run for any other office, possibly because he knew that. But his victory 5 months after a very similar coalition of people in terms of color and class and ideas took Britain out of the European Union does suggest that something is up. One event like that could be a fluke. Two in 5 months makes you think there may be a trend here. And when you analyze what happened in Britain in the spring, who voted to leave? How many of them admitted to the pollsters beforehand that they did plan to vote to leave, and that was a very significantly smaller number, just like the United States, that sort of hidden 4% who are going to vote for Brexit or for Trump, but never told the pollsters. And so we get surprised on the night. They are the same, how shall we put it, socioeconomic ethnic group. They are people who are living in the rust belts of the respective countries, the northeast of Britain and parts of Wales and northwestern England, some of the Midlands as well, and the rust belt of America. If you look at the key states that Trump won, they were the rust belt states. They were Michigan and Ohio, where the jobs have vanished, and where the old white working class feels defeated and destroyed. Same group in both countries. Same appeals being made to anti-immigrant sentiment, racism, and the same idea that what we need is a radical guy who will change the terms of trade, who will get us back on track to the kind of glory days of the 1980s when everybody worked and the unions were strong and, they'll rebuild Cleveland and Buffalo and Detroit and all the rest of it. It has appeal. And the truth of the matter is that the old white working class has been horrendously neglected, particularly in the United States, but in Britain as well, and to a very limited extent in Canada, because in fact we don't have a Rust Belt. I mean, we have a very different system, and we have benefited enormously from NAFTA. Without NAFTA, I think we might have a Rust Belt in Ontario. But we managed to keep all the car plants. They went south to Mexico from the United States, but they didn't. The distribution remained between Canada and the U.S. remained the same. This group of people who feel marginalized, ignored, defeated, and are looking for somebody to blame, and they're looking for a savior. And there is a constant supply of potential populists. Every political niche is always filled. They're always there. But given enough, sort of fertilizer and water, they will grow and flourish. And they got the fertilizer and the irrigation in the context of what's happened to the old white working class. There are other people who voted for Trump, of course. I mean, there's some flat-out racists, even if they're prosperous. There's a larger group who are functionally racist, but whose dislike of immigration is fueled by a sense that their country is losing the identity it had when they were kids, and of course it is. And you'd be okay with that if you were flourishing yourself, but not when you're not flourishing. And so there is this incoherent cry of rage, really. I mean, if you think about it, both in the UK and in the US, the people who voted for Brexit or for Trump were actually doing themselves, this was a serious act of self-harm. I mean, outside the European Union, Britain is definitely not going to be more prosperous. It's going to be a great deal less prosperous in all likelihood because the European Union is not going to give them going away presents. And Mr. Trump, if he carries out all of his promises, is probably going to destroy America's foreign trade and create even more lost jobs. He'll also quite possibly get the United States involved in wars. We'll talk about what he may do in detail. And of course, Canada will be collateral damage in the trade wars, at least. But there is a problem here, which is that a large section of our society that was once regarded as central and, you know, the white working class. The, oh, well, it was, you know, 50 years ago, the whites were 95% of the population in Canada and 85% of the population in America, so it was the working class. You don't have to give it a color at that point. Have been abandoned. Even the cities they live in have been abandoned in the States. And they put up with it for a long time, really, and were put off with promises and voted for people who didn't look after them. And, you know, what Boris Johnson did in London, in England, or what Donald Trump has done in the United States is finally to identify exactly what would mobilize these people and make them a powerful political force. I'm surprised it didn't happen before. And frankly, it is now a phenomenon throughout the West. There are elections due in France and in Italy and in the Netherlands in the next 6 or 8 months, all of which contain the possibility for a Trump-like movement coming to power. Front National in France, Marine Le Pen. She's running 40% in the polls now, neo-fascist. The five-star movement, Beppo Grillo in Italy, and the various extreme anti-immigrant movement parties in Netherlands, all doing very well in the polls. And the driving force is the same. It comes out as anti-immigration, it comes out as anti-globalization, because the understanding of the people who suffered is that somehow our jobs were sent abroad, or the immigrants stole them. But it's really about the destruction of the old working class. And we haven't done a thing about it. And as I say, in Canada, the problem is less severe because we've got the kind of country that actually does look after its people a little bit better. And we have been sheltered by the NAFTA agreement, no doubt about it. But we have a problem here, which is right through the industrialized world. I mean, I'm waiting for to see it happen in Japan. Bound to happen there as well. I mean, Japan didn't used to have people sleeping under bridges. It does now. So, what is Mr. Trump going to do? How far will the infection spread? What is at risk? And I guess, in the end, what do we do about it? Listen to Trump, and the first thing you've got to figure out is whether he means what he says or not, because he is all over the map. But I think there are certain things that you have to take very seriously that he says. I think all the promises he has made to destroy NAFTA, to impose a 45% tariff on all Chinese-made goods imported into the United States, and a 35% tariff on all Mexican-made goods, you know, which are actually made by American companies that relocated to these low-waged areas and use free trade to export the products back to the United States, so they're still filling the American market, but they're not paying American wages anymore. These promises are real. He's going to do that stuff. That is something he has to do in terms of fulfilling the expectations of the people who voted for him. Which poses Canada rather a large problem. About 80% of our foreign trade is with the United States, and we are more heavily dependent on foreign trade than almost any other industrialized Western country. It could get very ugly. They're trying to talk calmly in Ottawa about it, but beneath the surface, they're in a flat panic. Can you use your ties with American industry and American unions to somehow buffer yourself from this? I don't know. They don't know. They're going to try. I mean, you can already see the Canadian government reopening consulates that got shut down in lots of American cities. We need American allies in Congress to, if we hope to limit the damage from what Mr. Trump's going to do. But he is going to do it. So it's going to be rough around here for a while, I think. In Mexico, it's going to be catastrophically rough. And China is really scary. China is already in very deep economic trouble. They didn't have a recession after the 2008 crash because they pumped so much money into the economy, mainly in building useless infrastructure, but it provided jobs, that they managed to keep wages and employment levels up. But it's 8 years later, and that trick is running out of steam. And the Chinese government itself admits, well, claims, that the current level of economic growth in China is around 6% a year. They've come down from 10 to 8 to saying 7 at the beginning of this year to saying 6.5. I would be astounded if it was 4%, and it may be zero. They're lying. They're clearly lying. There's all sorts of indicators that aren't where they would be if there really was that level of economic growth. They're way below. Now, the problem with China, even leaving aside Mr. Trump's influence on the situation, is that the Chinese government is not intrinsically a very popular government. It is still a communist government, even if the ideology doesn't work anymore. And it's not, they don't even try to make the ideology work, but they do use the claim to power that comes with a communist philosophy. And they're not loved. They stay in power because they keep the goose laying the golden eggs. High-speed economic growth, a rising tide raises all ships. And as long as the money keeps coming in and the growth keeps coming in and people's living standards go up, the Chinese government is tolerated, but it is not loved. And if the growth has stopped or is stopping, it's in trouble. And already there's millions of people being laid off in the Chinese steel industry, for example. Literally millions of people being laid off. Add to that an American interruption on the export trade to the United States, which is at the core of high-speed Chinese growth. A lot of this industrial growth was financed and led from abroad by American companies going offshore. If that export trade to the United States is seriously interrupted, what is already a pretty dismal economic situation will go critical in China. And I would expect at that point serious protest against the Chinese communist monopoly of power. What do they do in order to divert that anger? And the answer is they look for foreign enemies. So I can see a military confrontation growing out of the trade confrontation between the United States and China that Mr. Trump is committed to engage in. So hard times all over. And of course, there's other things that are going to happen too. Leaving aside the damage he does domestically, you know, things like ending affordable care or Obamacare, you know, 20 million more Americans losing their health insurance that they only recently got. But he's also abandoning, of course, any American support for attempts to curb global warming. The rather promising, a better, as good as you could have hoped for agreement that we got out of the Paris conference last December, he has announced that he's going to cancel. Well, he can't do that because 87 countries have already ratified it, but he can certainly pull America out and do his best to sabotage, as he will do, a global accord or the enforcement of global rules on emissions. This is very serious stuff because we are in deep trouble now. The hottest 5 years in history have all been in the last 6 years. And for the last, it's now 14 months, I believe, every month has broken the record for that month at any time in terms of average global temperature. We may be heading into runaway right now, in which case even Paris won't save us. But assuming that it is perhaps just a statistical deviation and we'll drop back, we still don't have a lot of time and we're going to lose a lot of it, just like we did with Mr. Bush. We're going to lose a lot of time that we can't afford to spare on climate change. And he is going to make a deal with the Russians almost certainly that will finally destroy Islamic State, but it will also put Assad back in power in all of Syria. I'm ambivalent about that, because without some solution, brutal solution like that, the war could go on there as long as the Lebanese civil war went on next door, and that was 15 years. So I don't regard that as an unmitigated disaster. But he is a bull in a china shop, and it's a rather packed china shop. So we have some serious problems coming up, including Canada, from our perspective, especially Canada. But I want to challenge the assumption that this is really about globalization and immigration taking the jobs. Because I don't think that's what's taking the jobs. In the 80s, when you started getting the first real globalization, the first global free trade deals, and you know, became possible to offshore stuff, to move abroad, manufacture stuff, export it back to your home country, you know, at, you know, larger profits, far lower wages where you moved to. Then definitely jobs were being shipped out. Although I would say, by the way, that half the jobs in the Rust Belt that did get shipped out got shipped south to the southern states of the United States, the Sun Belt. They didn't go to Mexico. They didn't go, I mean, they think that in Cleveland, but actually they're now in Alabama. But increasingly, as time has gone on, the jobs are not being exported. That's not the principal source of the loss of jobs. Nor is immigration. Any study I have seen suggests that immigration has nowhere created a shortage of jobs. First jobs immigrants get generally are jobs nobody else wants. And as they move up the food chain, the economy is expanding with them. And there's no evidence that employment rates in Canada, for example, have responded negatively to very high, by world standards, rates of Canadian immigration. We're right up on the top rank in terms of the proportion of our population we take in as immigrants, and I can see no damage. In fact, all the places that are thriving economically in Canada is the places where there's lots of immigrants. I'm pleased to see the Saskatchewan is, at least in the city, is doing its bit. But I don't think it's the jobs going abroad. And I don't think it's the immigrants stealing the jobs. I think something else is going on here. And until we address that, I don't think we have a hope of dealing with the kind of phenomena that put Mr. Trump in power. The jobs are evaporating because automation is eating them. That's what's really happening. Didn't even get mentioned in either the Brexit referendum public discussion or the American election campaign recently finished. But look at the numbers. American manufacturing in 1979, I can't remember the number, so we'll say X trillion dollars of product in 1979. They did the same survey in 2014, and in constant dollar terms, allowing for inflation, American industrial production in 2014 was 2x. It's doubled. America is still the second largest manufacturing country on the planet, and since a great deal of the production in China is going to feed a population 4x as large, in terms of high-end industrial production, it's probably still the largest on the planet. What's disappeared is the jobs that produce that larger industrial output, because they're not required. We began by losing the easily automated jobs on assembly lines, repetitive, relatively simple. Then we started losing the jobs like bank tellers, rather more sophisticated, you know, three or four complicated operations being carried out, money in, money out, moving money between accounts, got to recognize the customer and make sure she is the person she says she is. All of that is now done by the machine in the wall. Mind you, it doesn't recognize you as a person by your face, but the magnetic strip on your card will do it just as well. And so every ATM is the ghost of three bank tellers, as they say. And as the algorithms get more sophisticated and the programs grow bigger and smarter, and you can start now calling it artificial intelligence, AI, it's moving into, for example, the various support functions in the legal profession and the medical profession, initial diagnosis, initial, you know, conveyancing, things like that. Jobs disappearing there. You can have a university degree and lose your job to automation. Just depends what you do. Sorry, did I upset anybody here? And a study was done in the United States, but by a couple of Oxford economists, actually, very respected ones. They did a study in 2013, and what they did was they tried to figure out what proportion of American jobs were vulnerable to being destroyed by automation in the coming 20 years, counting from 2013. And they did it trade by trade. I mean, you know, this was a fine-grained analysis of when do these jobs become vulnerable. They're too sophisticated. You require too much flexibility to automate them now. But, you know, Moore's law, computing capacity doubles every 2 years, still true. And so when will it reach the point where these jobs can be done more cheaply by machines? And the number they came up with was 47% of existing American jobs are vulnerable to replacement by AI in the next 20 years. What we have here is a phenomenon comparable in its implications to the first Industrial Revolution. The jobs are not coming back. We're not becoming poor. This is not necessarily a disaster. The machines are producing what we used to produce, and presumably the point of producing things was because we needed them, and they're still there. And they will continue to be there. The problem is only, how do you deal with both the spare time and the lack of money of the people who are not required to do that production anymore? How do you keep them fully integrated members of society who can raise their family, support themselves, have a real life, and not feel marginalized, cast aside, neglected, humiliated? That's the task. I mean, I think that is the political task for the next generation at least. The change is going to be big. It won't be in terms of moving people, let's say, from farms to cities, as big as the Industrial Revolution was the first time. But in terms of changing the way people work and spend their days, it will be just as big as uprooting the farmers of England in the 1780s and making them the working classes of Manchester by 1850. That big. And so we've got to figure out how we cope with a society, a very rich society that can support all of its members but doesn't require the labor of all of its members. That's the task to come. And there's already people nibbling at the edges of this problem. I don't know if you noticed, you didn't get much coverage over here, I think. The Swiss had a referendum early this year on a guaranteed national income, which is an attempt to address exactly this problem. I mean, they say, you know, in Switzerland, you can get a subject on the ballot for a referendum if you can get 100,000 people to sign it. And there's, you know, 8 million Swiss, so they got the numbers and they put it on the ballot. Obviously, too early for a guaranteed national income to be accepted by the bulk of the population. Well, they're not working, why should they have any money? And so the referendum result was no. But you can see people are thinking here, how do we deal with this problem? We've got enough money. Everybody should have a share. I'm not talking communism here, but I am talking, you know, fair's fair. We don't need everybody to work, but you've been here all along and you are entitled to you know, to share the benefits of what we've accomplished here collectively. And no, there will still be 53% of jobs in 20 years' time that will require actual human input, and that's fine, and you get top up your income if you can get one of those jobs, but you probably won't keep it all the time. That's one approach. There are others. I just mentioned that one because it's actually got out into daylight already. But that's, I think, what we're going to have to do. It's not the worst task you could be set, how to distribute abundance fairly. But, of course, in the meantime, we've got to get through the shitstorm that Mr. Trump is going to drop on us. So there you go. Life as usual. Thank you very much. I haven't got a working clock. For 10 minutes left. That's about right. I'm running out of voice anyway. Questions, comments, and, of course, mics in the aisles.
Yes. So thanks again for coming. I appreciate ending on how do we fix this. How do you convince people that just voted for Trump that a universal basic income is probably in their best interest and will probably be needed to be funded by some sort of wealth tax when...
How do you persuade people? Damned if I know. I mean, a lot of people tried, didn't they? And they didn't make much progress. I think before the people who voted for Trump will listen to you, they have to be feeling a lot better about themselves. So that's the end you got to address. I mean, in one thing, you notice one of the things Trump said, he's not stupid, you know, or at least he's selectively stupid. About rebuilding infrastructure, you know what he's talking about. He is going to go and reward his voters in the Rust Belt states by rebuilding, you know, Cleveland and Buffalo and Detroit. And God bless him, he should. You know, we owe those people something. And once they can see that somebody is addressing their issues, they will actually be able to hear you talk when you talk, but they can't at the moment. They're going, la, 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 la. They don't want to hear that stuff. They want to hear somebody say, we're going to kick over all the existing systems and punish everybody who's neglected you for so long. You know, a lot of people, frankly, understand that Trump is a loose cannon, and they voted for him anyway because they just don't care anymore about consequences. They're so fed up. They're so angry. And you got to address that before you can get them to listen. Yes, please.
So you talked about terrorism not being as big a problem as we thought. I could buy that argument. The problem with it is the amount of displacement that's been caused by the refugees and the people overflowing into Europe and other countries in terms of the destabilization of those countries, cultures, and their ability to accommodate people in a way that they can get meaningful employment, live lives, integrate into society. So, I mean, it's just a comment. And so a small problem has created a much bigger problem.
Yeah.
And we have to figure out how to solve that. So that's just a comment. I don't know if you want to comment on that. But I do have a question.
Good. I'm still here.
You did not comment on the African wing of the Al-Qaeda influenced terrorists.
No.
Could you talk about that? Thank you.
Okay, the African wing is mostly in North Africa, but it is also in Northern Nigeria. So we've got Boko Haram, very nasty group in Northern Nigeria, now in retreat. The Nigerian army, which is hopelessly corrupt, and in fact some people in it were actually selling both arms and intelligence to Boko Haram, but the new president, not that new now, has taken a somewhat more robust attitude approach to corruption in the Nigerian army. And they've driven Boko Haram back in East Africa. Al-Shabaab in Somalia is still on the loose. The African Union sent troops there to try to contain it, and some of them are going home because they're fed up. The Ethiopians have just pulled out. People keep talking about putting Somalia back on the road to being a proper state rather than a failed state. They haven't covered the first 100 yards yet. And there are lesser Islamist movements. I mean, I'm assuming, I'm not talking about Arab North Africa, we've already dealt with that. But it really hasn't penetrated that far. And frankly, whatever happens in Somalia, I'm gonna be brutal, apart from maybe Kenya and Ethiopia, nobody cares. Because it's really not gonna upset a lot of apple carts, you know? We've lived with it for 25 years already. Somalia became a failed state in 1991. And yeah, they hijack planes out in the tankers in the middle of the Indian Ocean, and there's refugees all over northern Kenya, and all sorts of bad things happen to good people. But it's a very local problem. It barely joins up with the Arab world. So that's sort of that African phenomenon is, you know, it follows in the wake of what's been happening in the Arab world, because in fact, to the extent that Africa, the northern half of Africa, is a large Muslim population, they all got it through the Arabs. It was Arab missionaries and it was Arab scholars who brought Islam to West Africa and to the Horn of Africa. So. They do obviously, you know, get a lot of backwash from anything that happens in the Arab world. Not so much for northern Nigeria, but even there, really. But it's not independently. Leaving aside what's happening in the Arab world, if you just looked at that in its own right, it's not a very big deal. Except in Somalia, and Somalia itself is not a very big deal. Yes. Oh, sorry, there's someone at this side now. Forgive me. Yes, please.
First of all, I wish to commend you on the presentation.
Thank you.
And that you have very much become a Canadian institution. Because, well...
Like maple syrup. Yeah, I know. It's
because while the Americans may have Noam Chomsky, I don't think he can elicit any laughter in his presentations.
Well, thank you.
Okay. Then secondly, there is just an observation.
Yes.
During the 1960s, I met a priest who had raised three generations of school children in Zimbabwe, of the Community of the Resurrection. He told me that the Shona people are unable to fight. They're such a weak and pleasant people, and he had seen them. And this was when Robert Mugabe was beginning to enter the fray, and Josh Malcolm was still leading. Yeah. And so things, as you present them, the status quo as it exists now, it is largely an Arab manifestation of a problem called terrorism. Now, terrorism has manifested itself in all kinds of ways throughout the years, where people want to overthrow, change, and largely, the leadership, society is divided, distinctly in three parts. We have the very rich who are afraid of losing their money. We have the very poor who are wondering where the next meal is coming from. And then we have the little bit want more. What we used to call in Marxist-Leninist terms, the aspiring petty bourgeoisie. And these, by and large, from every tribe and country, these were the people, men or women, who provided the leadership. And so therefore, we look for leadership among that class who would provide, out of the Trump, out of everything, all the difficulties that humanity faces itself at the moment, that we will miss. But thank you very much. Do continue.
Thank you. Yeah.
Around mid-October, the National Post ran a story that was trying to rewrite the events of the shooting on Parliament Hill. And I wonder if you think that was because they're showing a sincere interest in post-traumatic stress and RCMP officers involved, or whether they're just trying to inflate the problem again?
I think the latter. I think the latter. I mean, I don't make fun of post-traumatic stress. It's really serious. But, you know, guys who go through a year or so of war get post-traumatic stress. I know occasionally an individual can get post-traumatic stress from one horrible incident, too. But this is not a big deal, honestly. You know, we don't have people committing suicide because of things like this. And yes, I think it's manipulation. Yes.
First of all, I'm not a Trump fan at all, right? But I just want to ask, isn't the U.S. Congress in a position to maybe rein in Trump somewhat? Or can you comment on that? Like, I'm not sure how much he can do.
First of all, the Republicans managed to hold the Senate so they control both houses of Congress. Obviously, a great many American Republicans, including congressmen and senators, regard Trump as a loose cannon. But it is very hard for Congress to deny Trump a lot of what he wants, because he does have the tickets in terms of having won an election on the platform. It's not new stuff he's bringing. Their situation will be very similar to the majority of people in the British Parliament who hate the idea of Brexit. But they're forced to go along with it and try to moderate it at the edges and, you know, can we manage to keep a free trade deal with Europe and so on? Because they cannot come out and say, no, this is nonsense. It is nonsense, but they can't do that, especially because they're mostly conservatives, and the conservative government gets their support, whatever it does, you know, whatever that American hero was who said, my country, right or wrong, John, never mind, but you know what I mean, my party, right or wrong. And I don't think that the Congress will be a major restraining influence at all. I mean, Congress, particularly the Republicans in Congress, of course, are very closely allied with big money in the United States. Big industry, big banks, things like that. Who are going to be panicking as Trump unfolds a little Christmas box? But even they are going to find it, until Trump loses some of the shine he has with his current support, until he fails publicly in a couple of big things, he's virtually bulletproof. And certainly in terms of a Republican-dominated Congress, he's not going to have much problem. They're not going to lie down on the road in front of him. He'll run right over them. Yeah.
Given the new administration in the States, I'm just wondering what you think the future holds for the various military treaty organizations that the U.S. is central to, NATO, NORAD, their agreement with South Korea and Japan, and what do you think is likely to overshadow it with the Russians, or will something like that occur?
Yeah. Well, I think NORAD is sufficiently harmless that it's safe. I mean, it doesn't take a lot of money anymore, and there ain't, you know, there's no bombers coming over the pole, and so what remains of it will probably survive. The Air Force is good at defending its corner, U.S. Air Force. NATO is a much bigger problem because, of course, Trump has been saying we're giving all the other NATO countries a free ride, and if they don't stump up 2% of their national budgets and pay us for our contribution in terms of troops abroad and bases and so on, we're going home. And there goes an alliance that is now 48 to 2016, 68 years old. And it has, for all of its flaws, actually held Europe together in peace. I give the European Union full credit, but certainly in the early days it was essential to keeping Europe together. Is it required to stop the Russians from conquering Europe? Obviously not. The Russians have no intention of conquering Europe. Is it a safety comfort for Estonians and Ukrainians and so on. Yes, of course it is. All the Ukrainians aren't and never will be in it, but the Baltic states are and the Poles are. And given the history, they're a bit paranoid about the Russians. I don't think the Russians even want to take Estonia back, but the Estonians do, and it makes them feel a lot better to have NATO. So a little bit of damage there. But in a way, NATO is an alliance that has sort of outlived its purpose. The Russians, you have to remember, Russia is not a great power like the old Soviet Union was. It's got half the population of the old Soviet Union. It's substantially deindustrialized. Apart from defense industry, it is not in leading edge technology much. And the main source of income of the Russian government is oil and gas exports, not taxes. So we're not dealing with the Soviet Union. They couldn't hold up their end of a Cold War if we had another one. So, you know, how much do we need NATO? And the answer is it makes people in Eastern Europe feel comfortable. And apart from that, I'm not sure, really. So, you know, if he does go after NATO in a big way, I think he will be satisfied with little increases in defense expenditure here and there that make it look like he won. I don't think he'll actually tear down that temple. But if he does, well, I will probably survive it. Yes, sir. Oh, wait, yes.
I have a bunch of things. I'm having trouble remembering.
We are running out of time, so try one of them.
Okay, yeah. The U.S. unemployment rate is 4.5% right now, and ours is 7.2%. The city of Calgary, where I come from recently, is over 10%. Yeah. It seems to fly in the face of what you're saying about technology being a big driver, automation, but you're not the first person that said that, so maybe you can comment on that. And I find it amazing that the U.S., I was most recently in the job market, and the U.S. is not hiring Canadians. I don't know why. I was guessing maybe it was because Trump was threatening to cancel NAFTA. If he did that, every person in the U.S. that's Canadian working under a TN visa would have to come home immediately. So anyway, those are the most important things. Thanks.
Oh, no, it gets really rough. But the unemployment, there's a thing about unemployment figures you need to understand. Somebody did a work on this in the United States quite recently. U.S. unemployment level nationally is around 6%. That's official unemployment, which is counting people who are actively seeking jobs. If you want to know how many males, particularly males, I mean, it's true of females too, but to a lesser extent, how many males of working age, 20 to 65, are not working in the United States, the number is almost three times as big. It's up around 16, 17%, higher than it's ever been in history. I mean, there you can call them discouraged people, discouraged workers, you have various phrases used for them, but there's an enormous underground unemployment, what we used to call unemployment problem, already. And a lot of that is, in fact, jobs that just vanished. And it's a growing proportion of the, in the 80s, jobs really were going overseas and automation wasn't eating jobs. But the balance has shifted over the decades, and now I would say the biggest problem by far is automation, and going forward into the next two or three decades, more and more so. So that's really the long-term problem I think we have to solve. Are we right on it? We've got two people left. Fast, quick and dirty, and then we're out of here. Yes, please.
In both cases, in terrorism as well as Trump, you indicated media as being one of the key players. In general, when you see currently ethics, when it comes to ethics, not just among media, even in higher institutions, the level of ethical reporting has gone down.
I agree.
And because of that, there is a lot of misinformation that's going, and people don't get the right information. If they don't get information, that's why Trump managed to get away with all these kind of things he says, and it's not being reported. The reports that come out are either the media is scared of corporations who pay for
you know, advertisement money. That's the whole thing. It's rating. Nothing about truth anymore. So how can we go forward and get accurate information in such distorted era where money can do anything without getting to the fact?
Look, you're talking about the trade I've lived my life in, and I know how bad it is. But one of the reasons it is so bad, frankly, is that the business model is broken. You can't make money publishing newspapers. You can't make money running television stations even anymore. The average newsroom is down by 75% in population over the last 25 years. So the reporting that used to be done by four reporters is done by one. You mustn't expect in-depth analysis. They've got 2 hours to give to this story. And the reason the model is broken, of course, is because the advertising money has moved on the web. And I don't have a fix for that. I mean, it's affecting me in the sense that newspapers can't pay me as much as they used to. Some of them go out of business, all that sort of thing. But for people whose whole income depends on one newspaper, one radio station, it's murder. And the people who are left are run off their feet. All of the things you say are true, too. But I think the biggest problem is if there is no business model that works for the media that will allow them to put somebody on a story for 2 weeks, even if it's very important. We don't have that person. We fired him 3 years ago.
Well, we let it happen.
Well, I mean, I didn't let it happen. Let it happen.
CBC, for example, should be state government and people. We all should fight for that. Otherwise, how do we get information?
Look, I agree with you, but I don't know how to fight it. I really don't. You give me a business model that will actually make the media capable of employing the people who can do the job. Believe me, I will go out there and try to sell it for you. But I haven't seen one, actually. And I wish I had. Yeah.
Hi there, thanks for coming. I remember reading quite a long time ago that there were some Islamist groups that were going into poor areas of Pakistan and Afghanistan and different countries and saying, oh, you don't have schools, we're going to provide these great schools for you, and using it as indoctrination sites. And I was wondering if that's still going on and if it's something to worry about.
It's going on in a different sort of way. Something similar is happening in Muslim communities in the West. It's in this case the Saudi Arabian money building mosques and providing imams and so on. And they're not terrorists. But the version of Islam that has become the major Islamist ideology is very close to the Wahhabi version of Islam, which is followed in Saudi Arabia and which they have been exporting to immigrant communities, Muslim communities all over the planet. And though, you know, immigrant communities tend to be poor, you know, and if you're, you know, the first, I don't know what, how many Muslims there are in Prince Albert, but I'm sure there weren't many 20 years ago. And so you arrive in Prince Albert and you want a mosque, but you don't have the money. And along come the Saudis and say, we'll build it for you, but you do have to take our trained imam with it. And what are they going to say? No. No, they're not going to say no. And that imam will be feeding them an extremely conservative, fundamentally anti-xenophobic version of Islam. And it will be taught to their children as well. You know, the children will be going to ordinary schools, but they'll be brought along to the mosque as well, and there'll be some mini madrasa sort of operation operating there. That's happening in Muslim communities in the West. In places like Pakistan, it happens all the more. And so there's radicalization for you. Mostly it doesn't work in the West, because in fact, the mosque is not as big an influence on family life in the West as it is in a Pakistani village. There are lots of other influences too. But it is a problem, certainly. One of the things I really would do if I had the power to do it, and I do it in Canada, is not allow foreign money from state sources, and even from some donors known to be associated with state sources, to come in to build mosques, provide imams. If you did that, you would have to provide these communities with the money to do it themselves from Canadian sources, but I'd be quite happy to pay that price. And of course, you can't just do this for Muslims, you're gonna have to do it more broadly as well. But I'd love to get the Saudis' hands off Western education in Western Muslim societies. I say it's a good time to stop because I'm losing my voice.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Dyer, for your lecture tonight, and thank you to all of you for your questions. I think there's a lot of confusion lately about what universities are for. Provincial governments these days seem to be asking of universities that we train students for jobs, provide them with skills for the jobs that apparently are out there waiting for them, and also to undertake the kind of research that will result in economic innovation and more job creation. I don't think that's what universities have ever been particularly good at. Maybe what we should be doing instead is protecting jobs, shutting down our software engineering and our computer science departments. What I think universities are much better at, what we've always been better at, is the sort of thing that we've heard tonight, and that is thought-provoking analysis on the basis of long and careful observation and inquiry. So please join me in thanking Dr. Dyer.
Thank you very much.
That's it for tonight. Please join us. We have free food and refreshment out there in the lobby, so thank you for coming.